Welcome to the Cloud Marathon, and thank you for attending this session. I'll be talking about Advanced ETL with Power Query. My name is Dennis Torres, I'm a Data Platform MVP, trainer with some Microsoft certifications, and the leader of Malta Data Platform User Group. I live in Malta. On the right side of the screen, you can find my contacts. Feel free to get in touch. It will be a pleasure to keep in touch. And ask me anything, any question that you have about Power BI, about these subjects that I'm talking about. Our agenda today. This is more a summary of contents that we will see across the demonstrations because the session will be very demo-focused. Advanced web scraping, use expressions beyond Y. Sometimes the Y limits our expressions and we need to use expressions beyond the Y, creating parameters, parameterized queries, creating functions, and publishing. Publishing is so simple. Why publishing is here? Because this solution will result in something that the SaaS will not exactly support unless we apply some workarounds on the solution, and we'll talk a bit about that. So what you will see, we will be talking about what we can do. We'll be talking about advanced features in Power Query with the purpose to give you ideas about what's possible, what you can do with Power Query. I'm not too much focused about if you should do, if the performance will be perfect, if you should do this on the desktop, or if you should focus on publishing it to the SaaS. I, by myself, I prefer to focus on publishing to the SaaS and have a schedule of execution of this task on the SaaS. So, I'm not discussing here if you should do. I'm focusing on showing options about what you can do, and in this way gives you a different point of view of Power Query. We have a challenge. That's the point of this session. On this session, we will get a challenge and we will handle this challenge. What's the challenge? What challenge do we get? We get the challenge of the smart doubling. What's Smart Doubling? Smart Doubling is a website of open data about the city of Dublin. This site has many public reports that we can access about the city of Dublin. However, we are talking about government. Government usually makes this data open, but makes this data most difficult possible to access. And that's our challenge. Let's see our example. Let's imagine that we want to access reports about expenses and income on the city of Dublin. We have a page that shows this kind of reports. Reports called Table F for different year. We have a page full of these reports. And each of these reports has a link that we could use HTML, REST, or CSV. I opt for CSV, it will fit our example, it will fit the purpose of this demonstration, but you could use the others if you think they are easier. But I opt to choose CSV. Then you click CSV, what you expect? You expect to receive a CSV. Of course, you expect a CSV file. No, that's not what you get. When you click a CSV, you are redirected to a report page. This report page starts showing you the data. And again, show an option CSV that is supposed to have have the link to the CSV. But in fact, this CSV option has a different link that sends you to another report page, and this report page, this third report page, finally has the direct link to the CSV. Instead of just put the link to the CSV there, they created two levels of pages, and if we want to web scrap and retrieve that link to the CSV, we need to go down two levels of pages to finally retrieve the CSV link. Yes, I said that. I said they like to make things more difficult to us. So the information appears to be open, we can go there and see the report, but most people would give up when they see this format of distribution. Oh, we need to go down two pages to get the CSV. Most people would give up, not me. But it's not only that. This report that I'm showing, Table F Annual Budget 2020, is in the middle of a list of many reports of many different types. Besides that, this list is paginated. There is a pagination on this list. This means that we need to web scrap the pagination, get access to each page that we don't know precisely what number of pages they are, and then translate each page recovering the list of reports with their CSV URL. They like to make things difficult for us, so we can't put the data together. They like that. First, let's see a demonstration about this. Let's see what I'm talking about. Here we have the site I'm talking about, with a list of many kinds of reports. Only some kind of these reports are reports type F. The reports for income and expenses. And we have three pages. Three pages of many different reports. So I'm going to page 2. Page 3 has only a few of them, and I don't think has any Table F report. But for our script to be complete, we need to have swap out pages. And ensure to get Table F report from all pages. So, here is one Table F report and the CSV link that I was talking about. So I click CSV, and instead to get the CSV file, I go to a second report page, a page about the report, and on this report page, I have data, and I have the CSV link. Then now let's click the CSV link, hoping that this time we'll get the CSV, and I'm sent to a second report page, but on this second report page, finally the CSV link is here. And finally, we get the CSV about this report. You may be already going crazy. How Power BI will read this? Hold my beer and watch this. The steps of our challenge. We need to get the report list. Let's consider the report list in the middle, because the first step, I need to go down on the report list until I get the expenses themselves. But then I have the pagination. Let's consider pagination one level above the report list, because I need to repeat the text of the report list for each page on those amount of reports. And at last, we'll talk about publishing. In the end, we'll talk about publishing. So, report list. Let's see a demonstration about that, about recovering the report list. I use get data and where. I'm getting data from the where. I use the link. That's it. This first one is not difficult because the default web scrappy in Power BI is able to identify the list that we would like to retrieve. It's almost complete, but that's the list that we want to complete to retrieve. The list of reports existing on that first page. We are talking about the first page of reports. We are retrieving this list of reports from this page. Like select the table and transform data, because it's not complete. It's close to be complete, but it's not complete. And here we have Power Query retrieving our report list. Let's call the query report list. So this query is called report list. The first challenge is related to the CSV. We are retrieving the CSV word as a text, but that CSV is a link, and I want to retrieve the link to the CSV. How will I handle that? This is column 5. The step that retrieves this information has a statement, M statement, and yes, we will need to deal with M code a lot during this session. So here we have the M code HTML table that retrieves this information. Table resource. So we have a list of columns being retrieved, and we have a row selector in the end, how the rows are identified. It's interesting to note that we have a list of columns and we have a row selector in the end. This first challenge to retrieve the link of the CSV is not that difficult, but you need to turn this statement in many ways until the end of this session. So CSV is on column 5, so here is the CSV, column 5. I will not destroy column 5. Let's copy column 5 and make a new column. I'm copying column 5 and creating a new column that will be called column 55. So I have column 55. But what this means? What is this expression retrieving the data? If you haven't recognized the expression yet, it's time to learn CSS. This is a CSS search expression, making a search inside a web page. Yes, to make web scraping on Power BI, we need to learn CSS because we'll need CSS a lot. And what we need to do to get the URL? First, we need to handle this expression because I don't want the label of the link. I want the URL itself. A is the HTML tag for links. Good, but it will not give me the result yet, because I need to go down on the tag and retrieve one attribute of the tag. That's why these column specifications have a third parameter. On column 55, I can include a third parameter, which is each attribute's href. I'm saying that once the tag A was found inside the HTML code, like make a loop on each href attribute. Power Query requires that, requires this loop, although we know the tag A has a single href attribute. That's not a problem. So it will make a loop and retrieve the attribute folders. And now our column 55 is working. It is the result of column 55. We can already remove all the columns that we will not need. But before that, I have many report types. I have type A, appendix 2, appendix 2, and so on. Many report types. And the only report type that is interesting for us is the table F. So we need to make some magic on this column. Well, let's first split column. Split column by delimiter, I will choose a custom delimiter and put the dash. So now I split the column, I have two different columns. On the first column, column 1.1, I can filter and retrieve only the reports that are type F. And the second column has the potential to become the year of the report. So in the second column, I need to make a replace values, annual budget by empty values. So I have the year of the report. I need only to change the data type to whole number. So I have the type of the report, the year of the report, and some additional columns. The point is, only two columns are interested for me. The year of the report and the URL. Only these two columns are interesting for me. So, I will remove columns, remove all other columns, all the columns that are not selected. Remove columns and that's it. I end up with the two columns that are interesting for. However, this column, the URL of the report is not exactly complete because it's giving me a relative URL. This URL is relative. Let's make it better. But of course, I know the root part of the URL. I could hard code what we developers call a hard code, this root part of the URL, inside this column. But I'm not to that. Let's make something better. Let's create a parameter and call this parameter putURL. Type text. So the parameter is putURL. Type text. And the URL, the root URL is this one that will complement the URL on that column. Okay, so I created the parameter. Well, we'll create a lot more queries and parameters here. There will be a lot more. So let's start organizing this. Here in Power Query, I can create groups as I wish. And I give a name for these groups and start organizing my queries and contents. This group will be called parameters. I will set this parameter inside this group. And that's it. I have the parameter there. Now, returning to the report list, I will add a new column, which will be a custom column. This new column, let's call this column report first link. This will be the name of the column. And this report first link will use the root, the parameter. Mind, the parameter doesn't use brackets. I just type the name of the parameter. Concatenated with column 55. Column 55 use bracket. Let's click OK. And that's it. So I have the column report first link with the link for the second level page of the report. I can remove the first one Let's rename the first column to year, and without these changes, our first query report list is complete. So we completed our first query report list. It's time to get to our second query. We'll retrieve the second report page link. We'll use that link from the first query to retrieve the second report page link. We are not interested on the page itself. We would like to retrieve the link for the second report page. Let's see a demonstration building our second report page. In order to build the query for our second report page, we need to use one of these links. We have three. Yes, we have three. But let's make everything step by step. Let's choose one and retrieve the information from this one. Then, later, we change the query and generalize the query to retrieve the information from the three. New query, web. I use this link. Okay. It's retrieving information from that URL, but the tables don't really match what we need. How do we solve on this situation? We have the new add table using examples. It's not perfect, it's far from perfect, but it helps a lot on the web scraping process. So we use add table using examples. So I can see on the top my page, how this page is, and I need to include in the columns examples of what I would like to extract from this page. The secret here is to open one of the columns, double click on it, and take a closer look on this list that Power Query is showing to us. This list is showing individual values from the page. Then we need to choose which of these values we would like to retrieve. Well, after many testing and errors, yes, because I had to test and error this many times. So after many testing and errors, I know that the URL for the second report page has this format. However, there are many different second pages, one for HTML, one for CSV, and so on. Let's choose one, just choose, and we'll fix later if this is not the correct one. So, okay, and now I see a new table, and it's retrieving the URL that I chose. With so many pages and queries, it's a bit difficult to get track of what we are doing, and the names that you give to these elements. It may be difficult to keep track of that. So we retrieved the report list. From inside the report list, we retrieved the link for the first report page. This is the link. And I'm going directly to retrieve the link for the second report page. I don't want the first report page itself, but I need to go into it to retrieve the link for the second report page. That's it. That's why I'll call this query second report page URL. I'm retrieving the link for the second report page. The most important information here is the extract table from HTML. In applied steps, extract table from HTML. And we are seeing that it's extracting information about the ESRI REST API. That's not the link that I would like. It doesn't work for me. It's not the link I would like. So I'll convert this. By experience, I know how the page is. But let's imagine that I didn't know how the page is. I know nothing about this page. So let's get the link of the page. I open in Chrome, a new Chrome window. I'm opening the link of the page. This is how the page looks like. And here we have the links CSV, ESRI, ArcGIS. And we need to use the developer tools of Chrome. Yes, you need to know basic knowledge of HTML development to make this web scraping. And here we note the ID. And a bit below, we have the A tag with the link as HF and title CSV. CSV as a title. So we were getting the link from the long link, the ESRI REST API link. We need to use the title CSV to get the correct one. So, when making web scraping Power BI, the Google Chrome development tools will be very important. So, I'll change this to C. Sorry, not here. On extracted table, I'll change this to CSV. The retrieval of the attribute href is already here, so I'm re already retrieving the href attribute. So now I have the link for the page that contains the link of the CSV. See how government makes things difficult for us? Okay, but you are holding my beer. We'll get there. Let's go to advanced editor. The point here is that I don't need a table. I need a single value as a reply. A single value, not a table. So, advanced editor. I have here the extracted table from HTML. So the two operations below, I don't need it. I need only a single value from the extract table from HTML. Let's calculate the value that I need because I don't need the entire table. I need one value. So I use the m expression table dot first value and put the variable. Extracted table from HTML. My variable goes here and the result goes down. The result will be what I get as a reply from the query. And that's it. This query retrieves a single value for us. That's what I want. And even the symbol of the query changed because the query is not retrieving a table anymore. The query is retrieving a single value. Okay, that's great. Now that it's working, the query is retrieving a single value. I need to reuse this query to retrieve all the values for each report. How do that? On the source step of this query, the URL is fixed, is a fixed URL value. So it will retrieve always the same. So what do we do? Let's create a parameter. Let's copy this URL This first URL. Now let's create a parameter, new parameter. Let's call this parameter the first report page. So the second report page URL query will receive as parameter the link for the first report page and retrieve the link for the second. So, okay. I created the parameter, it's there in the parameters folder. I'll change the query so the source will use the parameter, which is called first report page. It's done, it's the same. So, this query is already parameterized. And what's the next step I need to do to reuse this query? I need to transform this query into a function. Basic development knowledge. We want to reuse something, we'll transform this into a function. So we'll be able to call this function from anywhere. So I right-click the query and choose the option create function. Let's give a name for this function. The query is called second report page URL and the function will be called get second report page URL. When I created the function, Power BI Desktop creates a folder for this function. It moves my query to inside the folder and create a new element. And you see by the symbol of this new element is a function written in M. So now I have the query and I have the function. Why do I have both? Why do I need both the query and the function? If I had to handle the code of the function, it would be difficult. Every change that I would need to do, I would need to do by code. And that's not something easy to do. That's difficult, that's challenging. Power Query knows that. That's why Power Query leaves us with our source query. We still have our source query. So, I can continue changing my source query and Power Query keeps a synchronizing process between my source query and the function code. What will really be executed is the function code. We'll call the function. The function code is what will be executed. But every time I need to change the function, instead of going to the function code, I will edit the query. Make the edition on the query, not on the function. And this is not an option. This is a very important rule. Because if I go to the function and try to edit the function, Power Query will advise me only once. If you get into the function, I will break the synchronization between the query and the function. Are you sure it was like that? If you say yes to Power Query, you break the synchronization. The query will miss nothing anymore. And as a result, you need to change the code of the function in code every time you would like to make any change. Besides that, Power Query also moved one parameter, the parameter first report page, to inside the folder of the function. Because Power Query believes this parameter will be used only on this function. So it moves the parameter to inside the folder of the function. Now, it's time to call the function. I can call the function already inside my report list here. I have the URLs of the first report page. This is the input parameter for our function that will bring the URL of the second report page. We go into the first and bring to the URL for the second. How do I call the function here? Because this is something like a loop. I need to loop across my records to make the call of the function. How do I handle this? Simple. In Power Query, we handle loops on the data like this by adding columns. The M language and the Power Query are expression language. So we handle a loop like this by adding a new column. And we have a special column for this, a column called invoke custom function. So we add this new column, invoke custom function. The name of my new column will be second page URL. The function that I call is get second report page URL, and the parameter will be the report first link. Okay. It executed the function and brought to me the second page URL. I can even use the root URL to complete these URLs. Let's create a custom column. In this custom column, second page URL complete. I use the parameter root URL and concatenate with the second page URL. Okay, so now I have the URL complete, an absolutely URL to the second report page. I can remove the first one, second page URL, and it's done. So I already retrieved the second link. Our next challenge is the CSV link. Using the link for the second page, we need to retrieve the CSV link to finally reach the CSV. Let's see how will we do that. Get back into our Power BI. So we have the link for the second page. We will repeat some of the steps we did before. We get one link and build one query to retrieve a CSV link. Later, we parameterize this query and transform the query in a function. See, it's a process. We can follow this process. Once again, it will not recognize the information that we need. So we add table using example, column 1. Let's find our CSV link in the middle of this set of data. In here we have a link to a CSV. Let's choose this one. Okay. So it's retrieving the CSV link, but as before, we can't totally trust the extracted table from URL. See, this will not work because it's retrieving a specific CSV link, and this specific link will not be what we would like. We want to get any link that is on the page, any CSV link that is on the page, so we can use for many different reports. Let's go to Google Developer Tools. Let's open the next page where we can see the CSV link here. Developer tools. Let's investigate this CSV link. And mind, the link has a title with the URL. That's why it's filtering by the title. But that's not the best option. Let's use the class to make the filter. So, here on our table 1, our place, instead of filtering by the table, I filter by the class. And let's analyze the result. Filtering by the class, we have 3 different items. Let's get only what is a link, a.class, so that's it. And let's get the href content. So I passed each attribute, href. So I have 3 links for the CSV, and I need only one. I need only one of these links. So I can go to home, keep rows, keep top rows. I'll keep only one row. And now I will complete the query in code. I need to do the same I did last time. Result equal table first value, and I use the table that I have, skip first row. And the result of this query will be result. And here I have the CSV link. Retriever, let's call CSV link. Now I need to parameterize this query. This query is using the link for the second report page to retrieve the link. So I'll create a parameter. I'll call this parameter as second report page text. That's put anything in for now, and I'll copy this parameter of the second report page URL to the link, second report page. So my query is parameterized now, and it's retrieving the information from the parameter. Now that I created the parameter, I need to call the parameter from the source task of the query, so second report page, and now my query is parameterized. Now I have my query parameterized, and I can transform the query into a function. Create function, get CSV link. Okay, same structure than before. I have a query, I have a function, and the parameter that is used only in this function was moved to inside the function folder. Now I can call the function, and again, same structure than before. I will add column, invoke custom function, the column result will be CSV URL, and the function query get CSV link. What parameter? The parameter for get CSV link is the second page URL. So it retrieved the CSV link for each report. Let's get back to our slide to understand our next challenge. Our next challenge is to retrieve the expense report. We already have the CSV link, and from each CSV we will retrieve an expense report, and we will need to join the expense report from each CSV into a single expense report. One more time, the same technique. Let's get one link, build the query for a single link, and then we generalize the query even transforming the query into a function. New query, web, and our link. This is a CSV, so the columns come ready for us. It's way easier to deal with this CSV. So we just click OK, and we have our expense report. Or at least we believe to have our expense report. There are some tweaks in the middle. As I said, government always try to make things way more difficult to us. Way more difficult to us. And the fact is, some of these CSVs have a different configuration, even different fields. So we have to handle this in some way. First, one different configuration that these CSVs have are a different case for the headers. This is critical. The headers will not be identified with a different case. So we need to select our columns. One solution here is to select our column and make a transformation to make everything lowercase. Everything will become lowercase. And mind that I did this step before the step to promote the first line to header. So all my headers are in lowercase. So now they are more similar to each other. I will have a better chance to match the headers for all the CSVs. But it's not that. Some columns here, they are not the same on our CSVs. So I need to control the next step. The next step already has a problem changing header types, because now the headers on the next step have all a uppercase letter. So in a magic tweak, I'll transform all these headers on this step in a lowercase. So let's make a magic tweak. And it's done. I can only press enter and I have the change type working. Some of these columns will not match with other columns from other CSVs and I may not need them. For example, columns SPI means previous year, while the adopt column means the adopted value by the council. Was the console plan to adopt. I don't need these columns, and these columns are not the same across all the CSVs. So let's remove these columns from here to prevent problems from now. And I also need to remove the heading from the change type. I do not necessarily need to remove the heading from the column, but let's remove as well. I don't need the heading. So, I remove from the change type, now I remove then as columns, hidden, object ID, alter, PI adopt, STMGR, delete. So I remove these columns. That's great. Let's call this report as expenses page done. Now I can parameterize this report and turn it to a function. The same process than before. The same process than before. I'll get the URL on the parameters. I choose new parameter. Let's call this parameter as CSV URL. Text, current value, the CSV. Okay, And let's change the query to use the parameter. Instead of this fixed URL, we'll change the CSV, the query for CSV URL. Done. Now I can transform the expenses page into a function. Function get expenses page. Done. Now I have a function to retrieve the expenses page. And I can get back to our report list and call this function from our report list. So I'll add one more function invoke column. Let's call this column expenses and function query get expenses page. And the parameter comes from the field CSV URL. So I have a table retrieved from each of these links. However, only the first one really worked. All the other ones got me some errors. How can I identify these errors? Well, the get expenses page is based on a parameter. So let's get back a link that has one of these errors. Let's get a link that has one of these errors and include this link on the parameter. The query will show us the error. And the error is the column object ID, which was not found. Yes, because not all tables have the column object ID. Let me remove the object ID here, and it's done. Let's check the report list again, and now the three tables are correct. Are bringing me a correct result. I can expand these tables, and it loads me the fields of the expenses. Use original column name as prefix. No, I don't want to use the original column name as prefix. I don't want to put a prefix on these column names. So, okay, everything is expanded now. And I can remove the additional columns that I'll not need anymore. The columns that were used to build this result, I'll not need them anymore. The column report first link, second page URL complete, and CSV URL, I don't need them anymore. And even on the expense table, there are some columns that I don't need. Object ID, I don't need. FID, I don't need. And doc, I don't need, because it's always table F. Let's remove them as well. And that's it. I have my expenses report. Of course, it's not complete, because until now, this expenses report is built only for one page of report. And we saw on the website, the report list is paginated. So we need to retrieve this expense report for all the pages. Let's call this query expenses report partial. Let's get back to our slide to better understand our next challenge. Our next step is to retrieve the list of pages that we have on the Dublin Open Data page, so we can retrieve the reports from all the pages. Let's see a demonstration, see how we will achieve that. Back to Power BI, I'll need to retrieve the pages. It will be a new query. I use the same URL, and I need to retrieve from this URL the list of pages on this open data page. Again, this is not something simple. It will not come out of the blue. I'll need to add table using examples. Again, I use column 1 to retrieve the examples. And here I have what is clearly the pagination object. 1, 2, 3. Let's get one and hope this works well. I can add new values, 2 and 3, and let's see how Power BI process this. Okay, so I have a table 2 with these 3 values. Okay, this time, since I provided 3 examples to Power BI, it retrieved the data correctly. It understood the pagination class existing on the HTML and retrieved the LI content. So we have page 1, 2, 3, and an additional item that is not a number, it's the next page link. How we will remove this last one? I can change the data type to whole number. Yes. Once I change the data type to whole number, we have an error on the last item. So I can remove rows and I remove errors. And now I have page number column. I need to use these numbers on the page number column to produce the link for each page. And I need this link for each page from somewhere. Let's create a new parameter. Let's call this parameter as report root link. So the link used as report root, and this is the value for this link. The report root link has this value. Let's click OK. And now I can use this new table and add a custom column. This custom column will be built with the report root value concatenated with. Now I'm using HTML expression. I'm using URL parameters, page equal, and the number of the page, which is page number. So number to text on page number. And now I have the correct links, the correct links for each page. Let's call this page URL, and this table is, let's call expenses, because this table will end up being the complete expenses table that we expose on our model. So I'm calling this table expenses. Now I have the other table, expense report partial, that is entirely built to retrieve the expenses for one page from the site. And now we are seeing that we have 3 pages on the site. So I need to parameterize this other query to be sure that this URL will be a parameter. So let's use the report root on this URL. That's it, it's done. Now I can transform this other query, expense report partial, in a function. I create function and call this function get expense report partial. Okay, that's it. And now I have a function to read each page of the expense report. And I have in the table the list of pages of the expense report. What's the next step? Obvious. I will add an invoke custom function column. This column will be, let's call Dublin expenses. The column name is not much important because it will not stay here. Get expense report partial, and it has 2 parameters. The first is root URL that I would like to pass the parameter that I have outside the quiz. But you see the UI here is a bit incomplete. Sometimes we can't complete the task that we would like only using the UI. Sometimes we need to add something else beyond the UI. And the second column will be the page URL. Okay, so I remove the codes, and now I'm using the parameter. It brought me the tables, and now I can expand these tables. It's loading the column names, and okay. I can remove the columns that are not used, page URL, page number, and that's it. I have my expense report for Dublin. I can get back to home, close and apply. So we have here our data, but in fact we have more than we asked for. We would like to have an expenses table, but we are seeing all the orders. These orders are helpers to lower the expense table. They should not appear here. We need to fix that. It's easy to fix that. We just need to get back to Power Query. And each one of these queries on the function, in the function, has an option called enable lower. We need to disable this option. These queries will not be loaded to the model, to the semantic model that we will use later to build the reports. So we need to disable the load of these queries. Now let's close and apply. See the refresh? It refreshed only the expenses table, and you have now here only the expense table. We may need to make some model adjustments. For example, the adopt value is the amount adopted by the console for the year and for those categories. So let's change the data type as a fixed decimal number. Fixed decimal number. So I'm changing this on the model, and now I can build a report over this. I can select year, adopt, and build a bar report. So I have the adopt information for each year chosen by the console. Then we can break down this report by categories and so on. But this is beyond our purpose on this session. What we saw is the ability to collect the information on a difficult web scraping challenge using functions in Power Query to make this collection. And it's done. Challenge completed. And about publishing. Can I publish this now to the portal? No, unfortunately not. These queries, in the way they are now, they are using some feature that the portal will refuse. The portal will call these features as dynamic data sources. The data sources are changing dynamically, and the portal will refuse these features. It doesn't mean this solution will not work on the portal. It means that we need to make some adjustments to the solution. What adjustments we need to do? We use web browser contents to read the content from the pages. This will not work. This web browser contents will not work. So we need to replace our use of web browser contents by the use of web contents. And the difference is not exactly on the web contents method. It's the fact that this web contents method accepts a second parameter, which is a relative path. The portal to execute these queries requires the query to have a fixed root URL, like this one. So you see, on web contents, we have a fixed string as the root URL. But then we can include a relative path to read different pieces of this site and make this read dynamically. So we need to make this replacement before publishing this solution to the portal. Dynamic data sources are not allowed by the CERF. Web script has a workaround, this web contents is a workaround for the dynamic data source. Other environments like Power Platform, data flows, and so on support this. It's only the Power BI portal service that doesn't support this. You could publish your data flow to Power Platform, and it would work in the way it is in the Power Platform, but not on the Power BI portal. For the Power BI portal, it needs these changes before publishing. Why haven't we done this way from the beginning? Because the web scraping would be more difficult. We would need to make the web scraping a more manual way. So it's better to use the UI to make the web scraping. Then after that, we replace the use of web browser contents by the web contents using the relative path. Some reference links about the content that we saw. This link will be very useful for you. And thank you very much for attending this session. Again, you have my contact links on the side. Feel free to get in touch and ask me any question. Thank you very much for attending this session.